The Road Virus Heads North. Read by J.O. Sanders.
Richard Connell wasn't frightened when he first saw the picture at the yard sale in Rosewood. He was fascinated by it, and he felt he'd had the good luck to find something which might be very special. But fright? No. It didn't occur to him until later, not until it was too late, as he might have written in one of his own numbingly successful novels, that he had felt much the same way about certain illegal drugs as a young man. He had gone down to Boston to participate in a Penn New England conference titled The Threat of Popularity. He could count on Penn to come up with such subjects, Connell had found. It was actually sort of comforting. He drove the 260 miles from Derry rather than flying because he'd come to a plot impasse on his latest book and wanted some quiet time to try to work it out. At the conference, he sat on a panel where people who should have known better asked him where he got his ideas and if he ever scared himself. He left the city by way of the Tobin Bridge, then got on Route 1. He never took the turnpike when he was trying to work out problems. The turnpike lulled him into a state that was like dreamless waking sleep. It was restful, but not very creative. The stop-and-go traffic on the coast road, however, acted like grit inside an oyster. It created a fair amount of mental activity, and sometimes even a pearl. Not, he supposed, that his critics would use that word. In an issue of Esquire last year, Bradley Simons had begun his review of Nightmare City this way. Richard Connell, who writes like Jeffrey Dahmer cooks, has suffered a fresh bout of projectile vomiting. He has titled this most recent mass of ejecta, Nightmare City. Route 1 took him through Revere, Malden, Everett, and up the coast to Newburyport. Beyond Newburyport and just south of the Massachusetts-New Hampshire border was the tiny little town of Rosewood. A mile or so beyond the town center, he saw an array of cheap-looking goods spread out on the lawn of a two-story cape. Propped against an avocado-colored electric stove was a sign reading Yard Sale. Cars were parked on both sides of the road, creating one of those bottlenecks which travelers unaffected by the yard sale mystique curse their way through. Connell liked yard sales, particularly the boxes of old books you sometimes found at them. He drove through the bottleneck, parked his Audi at the head of the line of cars pointed toward Maine and New Hampshire, then walked back. A dozen or so people were circulating on the littered front lawn of the blue and gray Cape Cod. A large television stood to the left of the cement walk, its feet planted on four paper ashtrays that were doing absolutely nothing to protect the lawn. On top was a sign reading, "Make an offer. You might be surprised." An electrical cord augmented by an extension trailed back from the TV and through the open front door. A fat woman sat in a lawn chair before it, shaded by an umbrella with Cinzano printed on the colorful scalloped flaps. There was a card table beside her with a cigar box, a pad of paper, and another hand-lettered sign on it. This sign read, "All sales cash, all sales final." The TV was on, tuned to an afternoon soap opera, where two beautiful young people looked on the verge of having deeply unsafe sex. The fat woman glanced at Connell, then back at the TV. She looked at it for a moment, then looked back at him again. This time, her mouth was slightly sprung. Ah, Connell thought, looking around for the liquor box filled with paperbacks that was sure to be here someplace. A fan. He didn't see any paperbacks, but he saw the picture, leaning against an ironing board and held in place by a couple of plastic laundry baskets, and his breath stopped in his throat. He wanted it at once. He walked over with a casualness that felt exaggerated and dropped to one knee in front of it. The painting was a watercolor and technically very good. Cannell didn't care about that. Technique didn't interest him, a fact the critics of his own work had duly noted. What he liked in works of art was content, and the more unsettling, the better. This picture scored high in that department. He knelt between the two laundry baskets, which had been filled with a jumble of small appliances, and let his fingers slip over the glass facing of the picture. He glanced around briefly, looking for others like it, and saw none. Only the usual yard sale art collection of Little Bo Peep's praying hands and gambling dogs. He looked back at the framed watercolor, and in his mind he was already moving his suitcase into the back seat of the Audi so he could slip the picture comfortably into the trunk. It showed a young man behind the wheel of a muscle car, maybe a Grand Am, maybe a GTX, something with a T-top anyway, crossing the Tobin Bridge at sunset. The T-top was off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.